I was born in Oklahoma. And when I was 6 months old or so, my parents took me from Oklahoma to Wyoming to visit a place called Devil's Tower. Now, some of you know of it and have been there, I suppose. Others of you have seen photographs of it and perhaps have seen Close Encounters of the Third Kind, in which Devil's Tower plays a principal part, if I may put it that way, as one of the principal characters in the film. Well, to the Kiowas, it is a sacred place because when they were engaged in their migration, they camped. They lived for a time in the Black Hills. And Devil's Tower is on the apron of the Black Hills, so they saw it. And to see Devil's Tower is never to forget it. It's one of the great features in the American landscape. It is a volcanic core, I suppose that's what it is. And it resembles in conformation nothing so closely as the stump of a tree. It's flat on top, and it tapers down and out, and it's a mile around at the base, and it reaches 1,000 feet in height. And so you see it and you don't know at first what to do with it. You know, it's so unusual, such a striking vision. When the Kiowas first saw it, you can imagine that they wondered what this could be. They were probably afraid of it. But what do you do when you encounter something in nature that is so alien to your experience? Well, you have to account for it. You know, you have to explain its presence or you repudiate your humanity. So the Kiowas, how did they deal with it? Of course, they told a story about it. The story goes like this. There were some children, Kiowa children, playing in the woods. Seven sisters and their brother, eight children. The boy was pretending to be afraid, and he was chasing his sisters who were pretending. The boy was pretending to be a bear, I'm sorry. And the girls were pretending to be afraid, and they were running from their brother. And in the course of the game, the boy actually turned into a bear, and the sisters were greatly frightened. And they ran for their lives, and the bear after them. And as they were going through the woods, they passed the stump of a tree, a huge tree stump. And the tree said to them, "If you climb upon me, I will save you." So the girls scampered on top of the tree stump, and as they did so, it began to rise into the air. And they were beyond the reach of the bear, who came to kill them, but could not reach them, and he scored the bark of the tree all around with his claws. And if you've seen Devil's Tower or pictures of it, it is deeply scored, as if some gigantic beast had reared up and scratched with its claws. And the story ends, the girls were born into the sky and they became the stars of the Big Dipper. And that's all we know. That is the story. But it does, if you stop to think about it, it does accomplish what a really first-rate story must accomplish. It explains the presence of the object. It relates man to the universe. I have sisters in the night sky. It is a quantum leap of the imagination. I've lived with that story all my life. And the bear, nothing. We're told nothing more of the boy who turned into a bear. But when I returned to Oklahoma, when I was taken back, an old man in the tribe came to my grandparents' house in Mountain View, Oklahoma. And my family and I were in the arbor, which is a summer house just beyond the real house, screened in, open on all sides so the breeze can pass through the earthen floors, a beautiful and wonderful place to be in the summer. Well, this old man came to visit. His name was Polha, which means prairie wolf. He picked me up in his hands and he began to talk. And he talked for a long time, and all the other voices fell away. And he talked about the good things and the bad things that had happened to the Kiowas in time. And then he looked down at me and he said, "And now you are Tsowai Tali, Rock Tree Boy, to commemorate my having been taken to this sacred place." And so that's who I am. I am a bear. I identify with the boy who turned into a bear. And I do turn into a bear on occasion. I lived at Jemez Pueblo, New Mexico, for some years. In fact, my parents, who were teachers, taught at the day school at Jemez Pueblo for 25 years and retired there. And in those years, I grew up to manhood. I was 12 when we went to Jemez Pueblo, and I think I lived there until I was about 17 and went away to school. But those were the most impressionable years of my life. And I love that place, and I love the people there, and I have wonderful memories of that place. And one of the memories I describe in this next work, which is called The Night Hunters, that's based upon something I actually saw. It's a prose poem. Now, prose poem is a contradiction in terms. There is really no such thing as a prose poem. But it's a term that we use, and it does indicate a particular kind of writing, a very poetic kind of writing, but it is prose instead of poetry. And if you ask me how I know that, I know that poetry is based upon measure. We say meter. This has nothing to do with that. Prose poems are not structured according to meter or measure. Iambic pentameter is 5 feet in iambic syllables. This is not that, but listen to it, and I think you will hear a kind of music in it. And when you hear it accompanied by the cello, oh, you certainly recognize the music in it. The Night Hunters. The light of the moon was blue and bright. There were men running. They wore white ceremonial trousers and headbands. What I remember most clearly is that they ran with a terrible concentration, an irresistible motion. They were all of a piece, the total sum of their parts. And they ran without effort, smoothly, drawing breath invisibly. They glided as if their feet did not touch the ground. It was different from their dancing on feast days, when each step was a pronounced striking of the ground as if pumping energy up from the center of the earth. Their feet and their hands, pounding and shaking gourd rattles, emulated thunder and rain. The old men in their white trousers and headbands, in their expressionless certitude, were hunting witches in the night. So that's a wonderful memory I have in my mind and will always keep there. And one day, it happened to be the first of the year, January 1st, my father woke me up before daylight and said, "We're going to Zia." And I said, "Why? Why are we going to Zia? I'm asleep, Dad, come on." "No, we're going to the crow dance at Zia." So I bundled up and we went there. Still dark when we arrived, and it was cold. It was cold. And we got out of the car. We went and he knew a man who lived in the Pueblo. We knocked on his door. He was up already, invited us in, gave us coffee and the fire. It was wonderful. But then, having had the coffee, we went out again into the fire, into the plaza. And we watched the crows coming down from the hills these dancers who were painted black and whose bodies were mostly bare. And I thought, oh, they must be cold. But it was a wonderful sight to see them coming down from the hills. And they came into the plaza and they began to dance. And men were shooting rifles in the air and welcoming in the new year. And it was a wonderful occasion. And so I wrote a poem called Crow Dance at Zia. The crows came down from the hills at first light, their black bodies charred, and they dance in the earthen plaza. It is the new year and beyond cold. Men of the village fire rifles at the sky. The crows hop about in time and breathe steam. Even before sunrise, there is color everywhere and the good smell of smoke and coffee. Where crows' feet stamp the earth, a friction rises, an old ceremonial heat, and there is in the ancient order a balance of all things in the universe and the formidable carriage of crows. Now, here is a poem that is really a kind of self-portrait. And I dare to read it to you because it is such a close poem, a poem that is so close to me. It's again very recent, and it's a little longer than my usual poems. And it is indeed titled A Benign Self-Portrait. A mirror will suffice, no doubt, the high furrowed forehead, the heavy-lidded Asian eyes, the long lobed Indian ears, brown skin beginning to spot, of an age to bore and be bored. I turn away, knowing too well my face, my expression for all seasons, my half-smile. Birds flit about the feeder, the dog days wane, and I observe the jitters of leaves and the pallor of the ice blue beyond. I read to find inspiration. I write to restore candor to the mind. There are raindrops on the window, and a peregrine wind gusts on the grass. I think of my old red flannel shirt, the one I threw away in July. I would like to pat the warm belly of a beagle or the hand of a handsome woman. I look ahead to cheese and wine and a bit of Bach, perhaps, or Schumann on the bow of Yo-Yo Ma. I see the mountains as I saw them when my heart was young. But were they not a deeper blue, shimmering under the fluency of skies radiant with crystal light? Across the way, the yellow land lies out, and standing stones form distant islands in the hold of time. There is a stillness on this perfect world, and I am content to settle in its hold. I turn inward on a wall of books. They are old friends, even those that have dislodged my dreams. One by one, they have shaped the thing I am. These are the days that swarm in the shadows of legend. I ponder, and when the image on the glass is refracted into the prisms of the past, I shall remember my parents speaking quietly in a warm, familiar room, and I bend to redeem an errant, broken doll. My little daughter, her eyes brimming with love, beholds the ember of my soul. There is the rattle of a teacup, and at the window and among the vines, the whir of a hummingbird's wings. In the blue evening, in another room, there is the faint laughter of ghosts, and in the tarnished silver, and in a tarnished silver frame, the likeness of a boy who bears my name. This poem, which I think will be the last one I'll read for you, it's called Prayer for Words. Prayer for Words. And it's taken from a Navajo song, the night chant. And in that song, there is a line, "My voice restore for me, Navajo." Here is the wind bending the reeds westward, the patchwork of morning on gray moraine. Had I words, I could tell of origin, of God's hands bloody with birth at first light, of my thin squeals in the heat of his breath, of the taste of being, the bitterness and sense of camas root and choke cherries. And God, if my mute silence, if my mute heart expresses me, I am the rolling thunder and the bursts of torrents upon rock, the whispering of cold, old leaves, the silence of deep canyons. I am the rattle of mortality. I could tell of the splintered sun. I could articulate the night sky had I words.